together. Together right now and bless it and say our King, our King. Come on, give him some praise in this place. Come on, give him some praise. You know he deserves it. Give him some praise in this place. Please remain standing.
May y'all bow your heads in prayer. Dear Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for bringing us through another week of trials and hardships. Thank you for leading us to this place. Today, let us worship your name to you see fit.
Yes.
In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
May y'all read the affirmation of faith found in Galatians 2:20. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me.
Amen. Please be seated.
Morning, church. How early may children become Christians? In childhood, the mind is impressed and molded, and it is then that boys and girls should be taught to love and honor God. God wants every child of tender age to be his child, to be adopted into his family. Young though they may be, the youth may be members of the household of faith and have a most precious experience. They may have hearts that are tender and ready to receive impressions that will be lasting. They may have their hearts drawn out in confidence and love for Jesus and live for the Savior. Christ will make them little missionaries. The whole current of their thought may be changed so that sin will not appear a thing to be enjoyed, but to be shunned and hated. Have a happy Sabbath.
Amen. No, I'm not Alvin Pickett. That was supposed to be funny. Can I get some love? Okay, thank you, somebody. Amen. But we're going to stand one more time and just have a nice praise song right here. How about it? Come on, stand with me as we lift up praises to God. Can I get you to put your hands together? Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. Let's say that again. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. Involved. Okay, Turnica, I'm watching you. I want you to be with me now. Okay, what we're going to say is you came from heaven. Can you point up? To earth? To show the way? Huh? From the earth to the cross. You can do the cross. Come on, mother. To the cross. My debt to pay. Oh, here it is. My debt to pay. There you go. I see you back there. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. And then what? Here we go. You came from heaven. You came from heaven to earth. Thank you.
may be seated.
Thank you. Thank you.
You may be seated today. What a beautiful song, amen. A reminder of all that God has done for us and just how far he went in order to save us. And so we give him all glory and all of the praise and all of the honor. Amen. Amen. I want to wish everyone a happy Sabbath to you today. It's a beautiful day outside today. Amen. Isn't that all right? And it's also a beautiful day inside God's house on today. Just want to take the time just to welcome everyone and just to bring a couple of things to our attention. Just want to keep a couple of our members in prayer. We want to keep Sister Thelma Southern in our prayer, who had surgery this week. She fell and broke her leg. And so she had surgery on the day before yesterday. And so she is recovering and doing well. So we just want to continue to lift her up and her family in our prayers. We also want to remember Sister Leah Jowers. Her brother passed away this past week, and so she is away with the family, and we just want to continue to lift her up in prayers as they prepare to funeralize him. Also, I got word this morning that Elaine McKnight, who is the mother of Claude McKnight from Take Six and Brian McKnight, she passed away. And so we want to remember she's in Huntsville area. I believe that's where she lives. So we just want to continue to lift her up in our prayers as well. Amen. Amen. Also, just so you know, on next Sabbath, we will be having our communion. It's our first communion of the new year. And so we want to encourage everybody to begin even now to prepare their hearts for our communion on next week. As you can tell, today is Youth Day. Amen. 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 And so we've been having a wonderful time this week. We started on Monday night, Wednesday night, and we were here last night. And then today, this morning, to kind of culminate our Youth Week of Prayer. It's been a blessing thus far this week. And so we just want to continue to lift our young people up in our prayers. Also tonight, they have a youth retreat that is taking place on tonight. And so we want to, if anyone feels so moved, there's still an opportunity for you to give a donation to the youth retreat. And so if you're able to give any type of donation, please note that on the tithe envelope, and we'll make sure that it gets to the youth department for the youth retreat. And so we just appreciate what God is doing with them, the leadership of Sister Stacy Epps, the youth AY leader, who's been leading out and planning all of these wonderful things for them. Also want you to know that in a couple of weeks, if you noticed, Aeolians from Oakwood University, they will be visiting Chicago on a Chicago tour. And one of the churches that they'll be stopping at will be our church here at the Straford Memorial Church. They'll be here not for the entire Sabbath school, so let me clarify that, right? So the flyer says 9:45. So if you come here 9:45 thinking you're going to hear an Aeolians concert, you will not hear an Aeolians concert. They will be here singing, but maybe two or three songs at about 10:30 on that morning, right? So we're still kind of working out the exact time and the details, but we'll let you know. But they will be here that morning, but they'll be leaving. They'll be singing at Shiloh that morning, and then they will be in concert at Kenwood Academy. And so we're inviting everybody to come out and be a part of that and support that. Also, those of you who like to stay at camp meeting is right around the corner. And so the camp meeting applications have been released or distributed. I have them in my office, so please see me for those of you who need to get those camp meeting applications in before the deadline so that you can have your place to stay at camp meeting. Amen. This time we want to welcome any visitors that we have visiting with us today. If you're visiting, we just want to give you an opportunity just to wave your hand wherever you are. Amen. I see a couple waving their hands there. Amen. We want to welcome you to the Straford Memorial Church, and we pray that God would speak to your heart in a marked way while you're here today. Amen. Amen. And that you enjoy the fellowship and the worship of his name. And so at this time, as it is our custom in Straford, we would like to get up and greet each other with a smile and a hug. So let's reach across the aisle and stand up and give someone a smile and a hug today. Amen. Amen.
Greet your neighbor, tell them that you love them, put your arms around them and praise the Lord. Greet your neighbor, tell them that you love them, put your arms around them and praise the Lord.
Amen. We can make our way back to our seats. So morning's announcements are coming from Sister Strong, are you here? Are you doing the announcements? Okay.
The announcements. Sit down, Pastor. It's okay. Good morning, Straford. We just told one another how much we love one another, each other. So at this time, I would like to pause for a few seconds to tell a very special person at Straford, or pastor, how much we love him. We have not been able to catch up with him this month. It has been his birthday, but he has been busy. He has been away. We have been away. So on today, we would like for all ministry leaders, elders, to come, please, to the podium as we sing happy birthday to Pastor Reed. He had a birthday on this month, on the 5th of April. Yep. On the 5th of April. And we just want to say happy birthday, belated, but we still love you. It's always good to say happy birthday. Yes, the Lord has blessed us with the best. And we just want to thank him for every day that he mature with us. And as we grow in grace, and he grow in grace and in stature, we just want to thank God for Pastor Reed. So at this time, we have a small gift on behalf of the elders, the deacons, and all the members. Would you please stand? And Sister Green, would you help us in happy birthday?
Thank you all. You know you don't have to do this. And Sister Dr. Pat is always surprising me. I'm sure she's behind this somehow. But I praise God for every one of you, and just for the love and acceptance that you continue to show my family. And just pray for me that I would be faithful to what God is calling me to do in this community. That's always my prayers. Amen? Amen. Amen. God bless you, and thank you so much.
Health ministry, save the date. What if everyone made and brought their best tasting and favorite vegetarian and or vegan dish to church for a huge potluck? Well, think no more, for now you can. Please be a part of the health ministry. Share your dish day, May 27, 2017. A sign-up list will be in the lobby. Come for the food, stay for the company. Enjoy the conversation. Movie night, Straford movie night, April 29th, featuring The War Room. Admission is free. Refreshments will be sold by our Pathfinders. Please see Jan Trust for more information. Pathfinders. The Pathfinders are seeking donations for the concessions they will sell during movie night on April 29th. Proceeds will be used for camping equipment and supplies. If you are interested in making a contribution, please see Director Jordan for a list of items needed for the concessions. Meetings will resume Sunday, April 30th at 9:30 a.m. All interested in joining are welcome to attend. Camp meeting. LRC camp meeting is upon us. In His Footsteps Together is the theme for the 2017 Lake Region Conference camp meeting. Housing applications and instructions are now available. This year, applicants can register and pay online for camp meeting housing and meals via our website at www.lakeregionsda.org or by mailing their application with payment. For a copy of the application, please see Janelle Strong. Applications will be accepted from April 24th to May 25th. South Suburban SDA School, annual spring fundraiser, flea market, April 30th, 2017, 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. 119 Chestnut Avenue, Park Forest, Illinois, 60466. The vendor fee is $20. For further information or to register to sell or buy items, please call the school at 708-481-8909. Community Service Food Giveaway, Sunday, April 23rd, 2017. Workers report at giveaway, 11 a.m. and 1 o'clock to 3 o'clock. While I was sick, you made me feel so good. I felt like the princess that I am. Thank God for you, and may His blessings be poured out upon you. Sister Hill. Amen. Don't make excuses, make improvements. Amen. Tyra Banks.
Amen.
Amen. I don't know if Tyra Banks has ever been quoted in church before, but it's the first time for everything. Thank you, Jordan, for the announcements on today. Amen. We want to invite Sister Strong. We have a second reading today, and just before we have a special video from the South Suburban School or our education superintendent.
Church and Pastor Reed, we have a second reading for transfer membership for Renee Whiting and Alexis Whiting from the Straford Memorial Seventh-day Adventist Church to the New Orleans East Seventh-day Adventist Church in New Orleans, Louisiana.
All right. Is there a motion to accept the transfer? Okay, is there a second? All in favor, please vote by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? All right, the motion is carried. Thank you. At this time, we're going to have a video, and then we're going to welcome one of the teachers from South Suburban School. They're going to come with some of the students there to talk to us a little bit right after this video.
Lake Region Conference is privileged to be able to operate seven schools. Not just seven schools, but seven academic and evangelistic centers of learning. These schools are Peterson Warren Academy, Flint Fairhaven, Sharon Junior Academy, Chicago Elementary, South Suburban, Capital City, and Calvin Center. It is our God-given mission to make sure that we are doing everything that we can in today's time to prepare our children to serve here, but to be ready when Jesus comes.
I believe that I'm called by God to be a servant. And my servanting, if there's such a word, is in ministry to His children.
I am a product of not only Adventist education, but Lake Region Conference. I started off in South Suburban, and then I went on to Oakwood University, and I know God put me in a place to be an example. Now I'm teaching at Sharon Junior Academy and I absolutely love what I do.
I think for the parents who are struggling financially, who have a desire to send their kids here, you know, God will open doors. The Bible says, ask and it shall be given to you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and the door will be open.
When students are working on something that they just think is the most difficult thing in the world, and then I'm able to make it a little easier for them, and then the light bulb goes off and they get it, it's such a great, satisfying feeling to know that I'm helping them.
We're a family. We are an extension of the home. And so when your child comes in to our school, they feel at home. They feel like they're just visiting family.
All wisdom and knowledge comes from God, and without God, you have nothing. And so I believe that Christian education has an advantage than public school because God's presence is there.
I invite you to come walk with us. If you have a student that you want to be enrolled in our schools, please take the time to get to know us. We're located on the website, or you can contact your pastor for further information. Our theme for education and Lake Region Conference has been and will continue to be LRC, wherever learning, ever rising, and ever committed. I look forward to you walking in his footsteps with me. God bless you.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. As you saw from the video, the DVD, showing you about our schools and the various locations in the different states where LRC reaches, we're concerned about your child, our child, your children, your neighbor's children. This morning, I'm going to have three of our students come before us, and they will give you a little presentation. But right before that, as I was reading in the book of education, and I'll just share a little sentence or two with you, it's under the chapter of the life work. It says, God's purpose for the children growing up in our homes is a wider, deeper, higher than our restricted vision has comprehended. From the humblest lot, those whom he has seen faithful have in times been called to witness for him in the world's highest places. And many a young person of today, growing up as did Daniel in his Judean home, studying God's word and his works, and learning the lessons of faithful service, will stand in legislative assemblies, in halls of justice, or in royal courts, as a witness for the King of Kings. Multitudes will be called to a wider ministry. As you see on TV, I saw an commercial, an advertisement, and you see a lot of them, for different items that are near and dear to people's hearts. One that you see quite often is for countries where children might not have enough funds to either eat or go to school, or even to have clothes. And while I was watching this one this week, the Lord impressed upon me, it's the same thing with our children, in our neighborhoods, in our families, in our areas, for us to invest in their education, and not just education, but the education in knowing Christ. One example, we had a student join us this year. This student didn't know how to pray, didn't know what prayer was. And so they would ask me to help them pray. This student had to move to another state, but before they left, they were praying. They wanted to pray. There were things that the mother would ask me and thought I was telling their child, and it wasn't me. It was their classmates. It was the Holy Spirit. The same Holy Spirit wants us to be dedicated involved in all the children that we see, whether you have a biological child or not. So we just ask that you reach out, you sponsor a child, you support Seventh-day Adventist Christian Education, you pray for us. And right now, I'm going to ask Mr. Chrisman and Mr. Reeds to come forward, and they will share with you a quotation.
My name is Luke, and I am in second grade.
Amen.
My name is Lynn, and I'm in first grade.
My name is Tony, and I'm in fourth grade.
True education means more than the perusal of a certain course of study. It means more than a preparation for the life that now is. It has to do with the whole being and with the whole period of existence possible to man. It is the harmonious development of the physical, the mental, and the spiritual powers. It prepares the student for the joy of service in this world and for the higher joy of wider service in the world to come.
Amen. So we want to thank South Suburban, and we just want to continue to lift up Christian education. Amen. Amen. In our prayers and any way that we can support, even if it's through sponsoring a child to South Suburban or one of our schools here in Chicago. At this time, if you want more information, please see Sister Strong. She has some, if you want to register somebody, if you want to know more information about the school, we do have some flyers and some informational packets that you can get that will help you to further understand what exactly is taking place at the South Suburban School. At this time, we're going to welcome, I believe, Children's Story. We're going to now have children's stories. So if our children could come, and if we can begin to prepare ourselves for our children's story today.
All right, children, that's your song. And parents, it's really your song too. Dig deep. They're going to be coming around with their containers. This supports the children's ministry here at Straford. Come on, let's sing that theme song. Jesus loves the little child. Let me hear you. Red and yellow. All are precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little children. Okay, folks, let's dig deep. And if you raise your hands, they can find you a little easier. I see a hand in the back. I see a hand in the back. Okay, we have some folk here on the pulpit. Thank you. There you go. Okay, don't forget the drummer and the organist. They make big money. Get them over there. Oh, I still hear some jingling. It sounds good. Amen. We're going to ask you to come back down to the front. Thank you so much. We want you to come and hear your children's story. And it's going to be told by one of our Straford sweethearts. That's right, Sister Kim Street. Let's say praise the Lord. And thank you so much for your generosity. Come on, young people. Thank you. Don't our children look beautiful? Amen. We're so blessed here at Straford. Come on down to the front. Amen. Okay, it's two of them. Come on, guys. Christian and Christopher, thank you for coming down. Okay, do we have everybody? Wonderful. Sister Street.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. I guess we're not doing a children's story today because there's no one here. Good morning and happy Sabbath. That sounds so much better. I thought I was going to have to go back and sit down. Well, boys and girls, this morning we have a word. Typically we have a word of the day. So today's word is, if someone can help me, hold it up. What's today's word? Celebrity. Now who can tell me what a celebrity is?
A person who's famous.
Okay, a person who's famous.
Person who is very popular.
Person who's very popular.
Person who has a lot of money or is famous for something they did or something that they should do.
Awesome. Thank you. Okay, so with that being said, I have to come out the street. With that being said, who is your favorite celebrity? Does anyone have a favorite celebrity? No one? Hold on.
Tom Holland.
Okay.
God.
God.
Who's your favorite celebrity?
Jesus. Jesus. Mama Change, who's your favorite celebrity? The truth.
The truth from your heart.
First
person from your mind.
God. Michael, help me out. Who's your favorite celebrity?
Denzel Washington.
Denzel Washington. Arlette, who's your favorite celebrity?
Luther.
Luther Vandross. Who's your favorite celebrity? Who can give me their favorite celebrity?
Two of us.
Mike Epps.
Mike Epps. Pastor Reed.
Who's your favorite celebrity?
Paul. The Apostle Paul.
The Apostle Paul. Let's see. Vicky. Who is your favorite celebrity?
Michael Jordan.
Thank you. Now, now we have celebrities. Okay. Who's your favorite celebrity?
Stephen Curry.
One more.
Whitney Houston.
Okay, those were all great. Now, with that being said, what would you all do if they walked in the door, except for Whitney Houston, walked in the door, or Luther, right now? How do you think everyone would respond? What would they say? Would you clap? What would you do? So everybody, if Michael Jordan walked in the door right now, first of all, Sister Patrice would let us know that Michael Jordan is coming through the door, right? Well, what would you do?
I faint.
You faint, I faint.
I see him and I say he can't fit through the door because he's so tall.
Ask for his autograph, okay. Now, what if he came through the door and he had money? You cannot tell me that if Michael Jordan, the Apostle Paul, walked through the door right now and everyone would just sit here like nothing is going on. Is that what would happen?
celebrity is New Edition. And I decided to take my bill money to go see them in Los Angeles because they meant that much to me. And I stood on the red carpet to touch their hand, to say, hey, I'm Kim, remember me? Like they really knew who I was. I took pictures with them. It was fabulous. It was the best experience ever because they were my favorite celebrity. Now, back in Bible day, Jesus was considered a celebrity. So, you know, we were on the right point when we said Jesus and God. He was a great celebrity. He was so famous that when he would walk through the town and tell stories, people were so much in awe that they would just stop to hear what Jesus had to say, right? So one day, he's sitting down and he's telling a story in the town, and his disciples, well, we'll just say his crew, his homeboys, decided to say, okay, yeah, this is Jesus, and he's telling this story, so we're all going to listen, right? Right, because we're all going to listen, right? Because Jesus was coming to hear, so we were listening to hear what he had to say. But some of the adults started to bring their children with them, because of course the parents wanted their children to hear too. Except Jesus and his crew were like, hold up, we don't want these children here. What are they doing here? Let them go sit in the baby room, because what Jesus has to say is for adults only. Right? Now, do you know that Jesus stopped what he was doing to say, I'm not having that. What I have to say is just as important for the adults, but it was more important for my children. And he said, bring all the children to me so they can hear what I have to say. So guess what? Even though we consider Jesus a celebrity, Jesus considered our children, which is each and every one of you, even the ones over there in the corner, a celebrity. So it's not about what we feel our favorite of celebrity is. It's important to know that we are Jesus's celebrity. And isn't that most important than anything? No? Doesn't really matter? It matters, right? Because I know if I'm a celebrity, I got my sunglasses on. I got my fly outfit on. But most importantly, I'm a good person on the inside. I know how to treat people, right? And most important than that is I have Jesus in my heart. So that means if you all are celebrities, that means who's in your heart? Jesus. And that's something to be flashy about, right? Amen? Amen. Well, I'm not really feeling it. Well, with that being said, I want you to focus on that this week, okay? So during the week, when somebody comes up to you, and it's just as important to know that you're a celebrity, but make them feel like celebrities too, okay? Okay? Who's going to pray? Come on. Bow your head and close your eyes.
Girls, close your eyes. Jesus, thank you for mommy, thank you for daddy. And my repeat is at church and amen.
Amen.
Dear Father, thank you for this day. Help us to have a nice church and happy Sabbath. And help us to have a nice sermon. And Jesus' name, pray amen.
Amen.
If you'll walk back to your seats quietly.
Amen.
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 It would be like the sky that's never sunny. It would be like the bee that can't make honey. Or maybe like falling snow that never melts. Like always hearing of your touch, but never felt. It's like a vase that holds no flowers. Never wanna sleep without you. Never wanna wake without you. I never wanna part with life abundantly. Never take a chance without you. Cause I'll never do my best without you. I never wanna leave this life abundantly. Hallelujah. It would be like the game that has no end. Like knowing love's behind the door you cannot enter. Like knowing joy's in a morning that never comes. Kinda like what life would be if God didn't send his son. It's kind of like a heart flowing through it. I never wanna sleep without you. No, no. And I never wanna wake without you. Oh, I never wanna part with life abundantly. Never take a chance without you. Cause I never do my best without you. Oh, Father, never wanna leave abundantly. I never, never, never wanna sleep without you. No morning do I wanna wake, oh, without you touching me with the dials of your grace. I never wanna part, I never wanna separate every blessing that you is I hate really nothing without you. Leave this life abundantly, abundantly. Since you came in my life, you're the source of my abundant living.
Good morning, church. Happy Sabbath. Okay, I'm about to recite a poem titled One More Time. One More Time, The Anatomy of Sin. It's that temptation that we're faced with. It's that battle within where we tell ourselves that we can just do it again. Just this one more time, and then we'll repent. We rationalize our thoughts as we're making our plans while convincing ourselves that God understands. He knows we may fail when we're put to the test, and we know he'll forgive us, so we indulge in our mess. Then, that one more time quickly turns into two. And before we can stop it, those numbers accrue. Then all of a sudden, it's a lifestyle of sin. And the strongholds take over and turmoil begins. We no longer feel guilty, so we go with the flow. Now the devil moves in, and he's running the show. So we put on two faces as our lives unfurl. We got one for the church and one for the world. For 6 days, we engage in what feels good at the moment. Then comes Sabbath, pretend to be sacred and holy. And it all got started with just one more sin. We finally know now what we wish we knew then. The enticements around us are hard to resist, and it's easy to falter, but the problem is this. That one more time we delve into our sin is one more opportunity for the devil to win. It's one more time that we shun the cross. It's one more time we decide to be lost. It's once more we ignore God's voice when we hear it. It's one step closer to grieving the Spirit. How can God's plan for our lives come to pass when our desires come first and His come last? And when will we learn that His way is best? If we follow His leading, we'll truly be blessed. He did all that He could to save us from sin, and He welcomes us home and doesn't care where we've been. Because of His grace, we're not defined by our past. So, that one more time, let's make it our last. Have a happy Sabbath.
Well, it's a song about him. It's not really a hymn. Yeah. So the hymn for this morning is about him, but it's not a hymn. But we're going to sing it. And the song is called Wanna Be Happy by Kirk Franklin. And it's in your bulletins if you'd like to follow along, which we would appreciate. Amen.
Jesus, take the wheel. He knows the road that you need to take. you hold for just 1 minute? Because I don't really think I heard anybody saying anything.
Amen.
Were you? Okay, well, good. Crank it up, Vince.
Sabbath, please turn with me to 1 John chapter 2, 15 through 17. Please rise. Please read along with me. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love is not in the Father, nor in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but of the world. And the world passeth away, and the lust thereof, but he doeth with the Lord about it forever. Thank you. Please be seated.
Amen. Good morning and happy Sabbath. Well, I don't have an elaborate story to tell you this morning, but my message is pretty simple. Okay, so I get a pretty generous allowance every 2 weeks, and I was taught very early in life that I need to return tithe. Over the years, I put God to the test without even realizing it. I thought about the times that I did not return my tithes, and I would always end up being flat broke every single time. But when I would return my tithes, I would always have the money left over and would even get an unexpected gift or surprise. As a result, I learned a very important lesson. I learned that if we are faithful to God, He'll be more than faithful to us. Now, I'm not saying that you should return tithe with a what's in it for me kind of attitude, where you only do it because there's an expectation that you will receive a blessing in return. I'm saying that you should do it because of how much God has blessed you, and that when you do it, you won't regret that you did. Will the deacons and ushers please come forward to lift up this morning's tithe and offering?
Happy Sabbath again. I know you all say, what is she doing up there? She is not a youth. So I said, come on, you stole me, but that's all right. I was going to say I would turn my age around and that would make me a youth. But that didn't do it either. I was still too old to be, you know, a youth. So I can, what y'all laughing at? They're laughing at me, but some of you all have that same testimony, amen? Amen. But we can all sing our Straford song together for blessing me. Come on. Let's sing, church. Just wanna praise you forever. Come on and stand with me.
Thank you. Thank you.
I robbed thee in tithes and offering. Ye are cursed with the curse, for ye robbed me, even this whole nation. Bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Improve me now herewith, said Jehovah of hosts, if I will not open you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be enough room to receive it. Dear Jesus, thank you for everything you've done. Thank you for allowing us to be here. I ask that you please bless those who were able to give and bless those who weren't able to give. And please bless the speaker of the hour. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Happy Sabbath, church.
Happy Sabbath.
Have you ever been in a situation where things are so bad, you kind of have to tell God who he is as a reminder to yourself? And so this morning, we just want to tell him that he is the King of glory, and that we are going to praise him and magnify him simply because he is God. All right? Is that all right? Praise God.
Thank you.
there anybody who knows that he's able? Now, we've sang this song before, so I don't want any more expectation, okay? I think we should all come together and talk about how he's able. Is there anybody that knows that God can do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we could ever ask or think? Exceedingly, abundantly, above all you could ask or think, according to the power that worketh in you. You, God is able to do just what he said he would do. He won't give up on you. He's able.
He's able. you're broken,
He's able.
God will mend you.
He's able.
If you're wounded,
He's able.
God will heal you.
He's able.
If you're bound,
He's able.
He'll break every chain.
He's able.
God alone,
He's able.
Make a way.
He's able.
Step out on faith.
He's able.
You've got to trust Him.
He's able.
You gotta believe
it. He's able.
He's able.
He's able.
God, we love you.
He's able.
God, we trust you.
He's able.
God, you're able.
He's able.
I want you to feel welcome to come to the altar and give God your burdens because He's able. So for those who feel so moved and have a special petition that's on the heart, we invite you to come down as we go to the Lord in prayer.
God's body, stand with, agree with me. We're all a part of. Let's go back to the top. I need you, you need me. We're all a part. Stand with me, agree with me. We're all a part of God's body. It is His will that every need be. Come on, you are important to me. I need you to survive. You are important to me.
Jesus, we say thank you. God, we thank you for waking us up this morning, putting us in our right minds, allowing us to have motion in our limbs and activity in our minds.
Thank you, God.
God, we thank you for the opportunity to come in your house and pray to you. We thank you for being an able God. We thank you for being a God who cares about us.
Oh, yeah.
Father, we want to apologize for our sins and our shortcomings. Mm-hmm. Father, day by day, we walk this earth and we live for us. And in reality, we should be living for you.
Yes, yes.
Day by day, we fall short of salvation. But thank God we've never fallen short of your ability to save. God, we thank you for your patience. We thank you for your long suffering. We thank you for your loving kindness, your tender mercy toward us, oh God. God, this morning we've come before you with heavy hearts. We are in need of your spirit.
We're in need of you, God.
We as a church are in need of your spirit. Father, we don't know how to love. We don't know how to treat each other. We don't know how to speak to each other.
Mercy.
We act out of selfishness instead of thus saith the Lord.
Yes.
So, Father, we apologize.
Mm. Yes,
nothing in and of ourselves is worthy.
Yes, sir.
But, God, you still care.
Yes.
You still care. Father, this morning I want to lift up those on the sick and shut-in list. They're not with us, but we know that they're on your mind and your heart.
Yes,
so, Father,
yes.
We ask that you be with them, dwell with them, heal each and every one of their needs,
yes,
each and every
yes.
one of their desires, exceedingly and abundantly above what they could expect.
Yes.
Father, we want to lift up the youth of Straford.
Yes.
Father, you outpoured your spirit this past
yes.
week.
Yes.
And we got to look at us as a church. So, Father, you know where we fall short.
Yes.
Father, I ask that you step in and you build us up, because it's not about us, it's about you, and it's about the light that we're supposed to be to this community. Father, our youth have a desire for you. Our youth want to know who you are.
Yes.
Our youth are trying to find their way in this church.
Yes.
So, God, I ask that you send your spirit to highlight where you would have them serve.
Mm.
Lord, they have a desire to know who you are.
Yeah.
They say that things are not exciting. Father, I don't pray that you give them excitement, for excitement is temporary. Father, I pray that you come into their hearts and give them joy.
Oh, yeah. 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 Hallelujah. Yes, God.
God, reveal yourself
yes.
to our young people.
Reveal yourself.
God, they are thirsting after you. We know that you hear and answer prayer.
Yes.
Lord, I ask that you be with the Spirit in this church. Show us how to love each other. God, we pray against the spirit of gossiping and backbiting. And,
yes.
and we ask
yes.
that you allow us to put away malice and evil speaking.
Yes.
Father, it has no place here in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Lord, we ask for an outpouring of the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Not for just today, not for just next week, but Father, until you return.
Yes. Yes.
We patiently await your coming.
Yes.
God, you've been so good to us.
Yes, you have.
We are so unworthy.
Yes. Have mercy on us.
Father, I ask that you be with the unity of this church. God, from the youngest to the oldest. Father, you have blessed us with a wealth of wisdom. But God, I ask that you tear down the barriers of the enemy
yes.
so that wisdom might be shared between young and old.
Yes.
Father, we are to be about your work, your business.
Yes.
And in the name of Jesus, Satan has to get up out of here.
In the name of Jesus.
He has no room in this place.
Yes. Yes.
Father, we want you to fill each and every one of us with your spirit, with your love. God, show us love through your eyes.
Yes.
Show us how to address the needs of people we encounter.
Yes, God.
Lord, teach us how to minister.
Jesus.
God, we battle with the struggle of wanting after the world.
Mm.
But God, there's nothing in this world greater than you.
Yes.
Nothing.
Nothing.
So God, I ask that you show us how to surrender our hearts to you. God, you are one who has called us to be your chosen people. And God, we accept that responsibility. We want to see you come in the clouds of glory. God, show us how to be a light in this community. We can't be a light if we're messed up on the inside. So God, please come in and fix what you see needs to be fixed. Father, we pray against attitudes. God, we pray against the politics.
Yes.
There's no room for it here. Your work cannot be done as long as self is in the way. So God, in the name of Jesus, remove self. God, we thank you for the opportunity to be in this place. Father, we pray that those who have come forward, they leave this place healed.
Yes.
May they leave with a new understanding of who you are. May they leave rejuvenated and redeemed, set free from whatever bondage Satan has placed on them. God, we know you are greater. You are the greatest. You are the Most High God. There is none like you. And we thank you for that.
We thank you, God.
God, I ask that you be with us in this service. Bring us together closer as a Straford family. And God, please just have your way in our lives.
Have your way, God.
Have your way, God. We love you. We can't wait to see you. And we'll talk to you soon. In your name we do pray. Amen.
I pray for you, you pray for me, I love you. I won't harm you with words from my mouth. I love you. Come on, everybody, I pray for you. I pray, you pray for me. I love you. I need you to survive. I won't harm you with words from my mouth. I love you. It is His will. You're important to me. You're all important to me. I need you to survive. You are important to me. You are important to me. I need you to serve. Come on, let's say praise the Lord. Let's say hallelujah. Thank you, God. We all need each other to survive.
Soon as I walk out the door, recognize this is a day that you have made. So I walk in love and put a smile on my face. But in case I run into someone on a different page, so help me maintain, help me maintain all my joy, God. Help me maintain all my peace. Help me maintain my sanity. Help me maintain my smile, Jesus. Help me maintain
my life.
Help me maintain
my heart.
Help me maintain
every part of me. Help me maintain.
Help me maintain.
Get into the word today. Father in heaven, Lord, I want to thank you so much for your son, Christ Jesus. We want to thank you for your presence in our lives that helps us to maintain, to keep our sanity, to keep our faith. It's you who supply the faith that we need to hold on. And so, Lord, we hold on to you. We cry out to you today. And we ask that as we open your holy word, oh God, that you would speak to us in words that are clear. In words that convict our hearts, in words that causes us to see just how wonderful you really are. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Story of a young girl that was growing up with her mom, and as most young people growing up, particularly when they get to their teenage years, they come to the place in their life where they want to live independently of their parents, right? How many of us can relate to that? At some point in our journey in life, there comes a place, comes a time when we think that we know better than our parents, right? Okay? We really do. We've all been there, right?
Yes, we have.
We come to that place, we think we know better than our parents. And this young lady, she came to that place in her life that she felt like she knew better than her mother. She's tired of her mother telling her to make sure she does her homework after school. She was tired of her mother telling, I'm getting a little bit of feedback, I'm not sure why. Do you guys hear that? Okay. She's tired of her mom telling her to eat all of her vegetables on her plate. She's tired of her mom trying to tell her which friends she should hang out with and which friends she shouldn't hang out with. She's tired of her friend, her mother telling her to get off of Facebook and Snapchat and Twitter, right? And when she decided that when she became old enough that she was going to move as far away from her mother as possible, right? Some of us right now, don't admit it, you may want to get just as far as you can away from your parents as possible. We've all been there. See, a lot of us are older now, and we act like we never had that in our hearts growing up, right?
Come on
Come on now. But it's a natural part of growing up in this world. You come to a place where you don't want to, you want to get as far away as possible. And that's what this young lady decided. And she told her mother, she said, when I turn 18, I'm going to move as far away from you as I possibly can. She started saving up her little money, and she decided she wasn't going to stay there. And on her 18th birthday, she packed her bags, and she left her mother's house. Her mother let her go, too. And really, what I want to begin to talk about here today is, in her mind, there was something else to be explored. There was something that her mother was keeping her from. And so she saw the world as an endless place of possibilities, of endless possibilities. She felt as if she had limitless and boundless potential, and that the world would really be her stage, and that finally when she left her mother's house and when she was finally able to do whatever she wanted to do, that she believed that then and only then she would be able to fulfill her real potential. And so today I want to talk to you about it, because there's something about, it is something about the lure of the possible in the world, especially when you're young, you know? I remember when I was 18, 19 years old, I thought I was invincible. There was nothing that I could not do that I didn't put my mind to, right? How many of you been there? We all felt that, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, right? Something about what we believe the world has to offer that causes us to want it more than anything else. And so I want to talk to you today on a sermon entitled True Love. What is true love, right? So I want you to turn with me to the book of 1 John, and we read it earlier in our scripture today, 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2. And I want to read from the New King James Version of the Bible. It's all the way there next to Revelation, close to Revelation, then to the book of the Bible, and work your way backwards. 1 John chapter 2. And I want to read starting in verse 15 of chapter 2. And I just want to read what we read earlier in our scripture reading from the New King James Version of the Bible. 1 John chapter 2, starting in verse 15. And here's what John says. He says, "Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world," he says, "is passing away, and the lust of it. But he who does the will of God abides forever." This is written by the Apostle John, who wrote the Gospel of John, was one of Jesus' closest disciples. He was called the beloved disciple. And in chapter 1, he opens and he says, "That which we have seen, that which we have touched, that which we have heard, this is who we declare to you." And so what he says is that what I'm getting ready to tell you about Jesus Christ, the person that I'm trying to introduce you to, the person that I want you to follow, is not somebody that I read about or somebody that I heard about. He's somebody that I actually laid my eyes on him. I actually touched him. I actually experienced a relationship with him. And so he's writing from a firsthand experience, and he wants to transfer this same intimacy, the same connection that he has, that he had with Jesus. He wants you to have that same connection with him as well. And so he writes to a group of Christians, this letter to a group of Christians, and he writes to them, and he wants them to know this Jesus that he knows. And he wants them to know what it means to follow Jesus, to walk with this Jesus. So in chapter 1, he says, "Walk in the light as he is in the light." He says, "God, the message that I declare to you, that he is light and that there is no darkness in him." And so what he's suggesting now in the book of John, what he begins to unfold for these Christians, he wants them to know what they need to look out for, the secret to remaining in a close, intimate relationship with him, because he understands that it is human nature that causes us to be in and out of a relationship with him. So, you know, one day on Sabbath morning when you hear the sermon and you hear the beautiful songs and you leave out and the sun is shining on your face, you feel on fire for God and you say, I'm never going to leave him again. And then by Wednesday, you find yourself turning to 107.5 WGCI or 92.3 FM, right? And you find yourself listening to Kendrick Lamar and Chance. So I'm trying to get those names out of my mouth, right? All right? So you find in the middle of the week that your relationship that you had on Sabbath morning is not quite what you wanted it to be. You don't have that same feeling, that same connection. And so he's writing this because he wants us to know how we can abide in him. How can we maintain that intimacy and that connection with him, even though you're only 14 years old, even though you're only 16 years old. Believe it or not, the God of the universe wants to have a personal, intimate, face-to-face relationship with you. Everybody, he wants to reveal himself to. And so he wants to show us how we can maintain this relationship with him. And here in this passage, which brings us to our core passage, the first thing that he says, that if we want to maintain our close relationship with God, he says, do not love the world or the things in the world, right? And really what that statement begins to suggest to us, that there is something in the world that is hazardous to our walk with God. There are pitfalls in the world. The statement suggests that there's some things that as Christians, that as believers, that we need to be careful of when we are seeking to live life in this world. Now, it's interesting. Jesus says that we are to be in the world, but not of the world. So what John here is saying, he's not calling us to this a life of being a monk or being just by yourself, a recluse and not having to do with anything to do with anybody, or trying to be holier than thou, so holy that you don't talk to anybody, so holy that you have no fellowship. You can't talk about simple things in life. He's not talking about that. But what he's trying to show is that there's something about the world that has a contaminating effect on the person that is trying to live a righteous life with God. And so he says, don't love the world, right? And so he's saying that the world should be avoided. And the first thing I want to suggest to you, the reason why he says this, and something that we often don't consider, in chapter 5, I want to read it, go with me, chapter 5, verse 19, he says, in chapter 5, verse 9 of 1 John, he says, we know that we are of God, and the whole world lies under the sway of the wicked one. Think about that for a moment. He's saying, do not love the world, first of all, because the world is under the influence and under the control of Lucifer himself. I want y'all to think about that for a moment, right? And what he's suggesting is that in the world, we have competing kingdoms, competing values. See, when Jesus came, he ushered in the reign of his kingdom on this world. But then Satan, who is fighting against the reign of God in the world and the reign of God in our hearts. And so he sets up another kingdom that is competing with the kingdom of God, competing with the reign of God in our hearts. Right? And so the kingdom of Satan is one that offers us something apart from God. It really has nothing to do with God. And so what he's suggesting that in our world, that there is aspects of our world is under the control of Satan himself. Now we often don't think about it in those terms, but notice what he says. In chapter 2, I want to go back there in chapter 2 of 1 John. Notice what he says, do not love the world, verse 15, or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world. Now he says why. He's telling us now why we shouldn't love the world. What are the things in the world? He says, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. He says it's not of the Father, but is of the world. And if we were to summarize all of that, and what he's saying, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of the life, simply said, it is selfish, self-centered human desires apart from God. Let me say that another way. What he's saying is that all that is in the world, all that Satan, all of that, all of his values, the things that he's trying to transfer to us, because Satan is seeking to communicate while God is trying to transform us into his character, Lucifer is also seeking to communicate his character so that we can be transformed into his character. And what he's suggesting here is that at the core of Lucifer's character is self-centeredness, selfish desires that he seeks to pass on now to people trying to live faithfully to God. And notice what he says about these desires. He says that these desires are not from God. He says they are from the world. And if they're from the world, we understand that, the whole world is under the sway, under the influence of Lucifer, meaning then that these desires that we are subscribing to or are tempted to go after, they find their genesis, their origins, their roots in Lucifer himself. They do not come from God. These are not the values of the kingdom of heaven. Amen. And notice what he says, the lust of the eyes, it is living for our, lust of the flesh is living for what feels good. Are y'all with me today? You know, some things, you know, I know that this chocolate bar is not good for me, but when I eat it, I feel good. Or it tastes good. I know that that boy means no good for me. But it's just something about the way he looks. I like his swag. He just makes me feel good. I know that girl has nothing, no good intentions for me. But she's so fine. She makes me feel good. And what we see here, the lust of the eyes, are feelings, cravings for things that are forbidden, that are apart from God. The lust of the flesh, I'm sorry, lust of the flesh. But then he goes on to say, not only that, but he says, the lust of the eyes. Now notice how Satan works. So he fuels our fleshly desires, those things that have nothing to do with God. He fuels them with our eyes, what we see. Stay with me now. So the way that he stimulates our desire, the way that he pours gasoline on our unholy desires, is by putting before our eyes images and values that only nurture the sinful nature and starves the spiritual nature that God has placed inside of us. So when we are watching shows that promote adultery and the values of the kingdom of darkness, then we, by beholding, we are becoming changed, and he is fueling our desires by what we see. The eye is the window of the soul. Yes. And what we are focused on, what we focus our attention on, has the ability to transform us internally. Fuels our desires through what we see. It is interesting, advertisers will tell you that most things that we purchase, we do not need. When you decide, sometimes you decide to buy a new car or buy a new dress, if you were to trace the moment you thought about that, was when you saw the 2017 Lexus come across the screen. You see, what advertisers do, they create a desire in you for something that you did not previously desire. Oh, you're not with me. Let me take it another way. Y'all getting quiet now, huh? So think about it. So why do we need a new iPhone every year? Or a new iPad. Apple has us, some of us cannot exist on unless we have the latest iPhone. What's wrong with the iPhone 5? Now, I know smartphones can do a whole lot of things now. But as long as I can still make a phone call and check my email, send a text message, now we're getting more involved now, right? And so what my point is that what advertisers do, they create and they fuel a desire for things that we didn't even know that we had a desire for. They're things that are not needed. And so what Satan does, it's the same thing. He tries to fuel in us a desire through by what we see, what he puts in front of us, for things that we don't need, to things that he knows will have no benefit to the spiritual life, but he puts it before us anyway. Then he says the pride of life, and really there could be the pride of possession. It is this idea of a focus on a certain lifestyle, right? So what he's showing here is that the world promotes desires, selfish, self-centered desires apart from God, but it also promotes a certain lifestyle that represents success by material excess. By living a certain lifestyle. So for some of us, you know, growing up, we used to watch Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous with Robin Leach, right? Right, we used to watch that show because they had this lavish lifestyle that gave us a picture of what it means to be successful and to finally arrive in the world. Then later, my generation, they had the MTV Cribs, and you would watch these famous people as they would show you their array of cars and all of their possession. And what they do, they begin to promote a lifestyle. When we look at the celebrities of today and how they're able to shape their narrative on their Instagram and their Facebook page, they're putting before us a certain lifestyle that says to us that this is what success is. John calls it the pride of life. He says this is in the world. So the world says that the more money you have, the more power you have, the more status you have, the more you will be respected and recognized. And what we see really here is that a revelation, it's an unveiling. All of these things, believe it or not, are all a part of the values of the kingdom of darkness. Not only is it just the values of kingdom of darkness, but it is Lucifer's character. I shall be like the Most High. Self-promoting, self-exaltation. Success is determined when I become the king of the hill, when I'm the best, when everybody worships me. When I have the most likes and the retweets. Now it's quiet. The values, here he calls it the pride of life. Now, here's why he is warning against these things. And what's interesting about this, many of these same values now are not just out in the world. There is a success gospel now. There's the prosperity gospel, name it and claim it. But then the Adventist Church has the success gospel. Huh? Go and get your degree, and as long as you keep God in the picture, then you're okay. Oh, let me say it another way. Go out and be in the world, but just keep the Sabbath holy. The rest of the week, you can pursue all of the values of the kingdom of the world, but just keep the seventh day Sabbath holy, and you'll be okay with God. God's view of success is totally different from our view of success. But here's the danger now of the world. I want to get to this. Here's a danger. Notice what he says in verse 15. He says, "Do not love the world or the things of the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him." Oh, stay with me now. He's saying that if you are enraptured and your affections are in the values of the world, if you want what the world has to offer, then it separates us from God, because you cannot love God and love the world at the same time. You've got to choose between one or the other. And so what John is trying to show us is that the pursuit of the values of the kingdom of the world is that it separates us from a relationship with God. It causes us, hear me now, to not only not want to know him, but not want to have anything to do with him. See, we underestimate the values of the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life that it has on the human heart. Now think about it for a moment. We know the story of the rich young ruler, right? He comes to Jesus in the Bible, and Mark tells the story of a rich young man in the prime of his life who is wealthy. He keeps the Sabbath. He keeps the law. He tithes. He has a lot of money. And he comes to Jesus because he is impressed by Jesus. He wants what Jesus has. He sees the power and the splendor of who he is. His heart goes out to him. But when Jesus says to him, if you want to be my disciple, you've got to sell everything, the Bible says that he went away sad. Why? Because he had many possessions. He loved his possessions more than Jesus. Here was Jesus. If he could see Jesus face to face and reject him, saw the demonstration of his power, looked him in the eyes. And they speculate that he could have actually been, instead of 12 disciples, that there could have been actually 13 disciples in the Bible that we taught. He could have been the 13th one. But the pride of life, he didn't want to lose his status. He didn't want to lose his place in the world. He would rather hold on to those things than to hold on to God. And here's what we're learning about the deceptive nature of the world. The world is that when we love the world and the values of the world, we cannot have an appreciation for Christ or spiritual things. When you are in pursuit of something else other than Jesus Christ, you will not appreciate the things of God. I remember when I was getting ready to go to Oakwood my first time, and I think I said this to you before, one of my mentors, everybody's giving, you know, you have your trunk party, and they're giving you different things you need to go away to college, and she whipped out a brand new Bible. That's how I felt too. Oh, thank you. A Bible. What I've always wanted. And when I look back on that now, I realize is that in my mind, in my heart, I could not appreciate the Word of God. And what the Word of God had to say was because I had different values. I was in another pursuit. I love the world. See, some of us, we don't want to admit that we love the world. We think that people that love the world are people that are out in the streets, that are on drugs, or who never come to church. But you can be in the church. That's why John is writing to a group of Christians. You can be in the church and still love the world, and because you love the world, lack an appreciation for the Spirit of God moving in our hearts. That's why Paul says spiritual things are spiritually discerned. When we have competing affections, it is, Ellen White says, it is impossible to discern truth and appreciate the sacred things of God. Love for the world perverts our affections. It is like giving a child cotton candy every day for breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and then all of a sudden introducing broccoli and carrots. It's going to be the worst thing you've ever tasted. It's going to be the worst thing they're going to spit it out of their mouths. And that's what it's like being in love with the world. It is like feasting on cotton candy that's not good for you. It makes you feel good in the moment, but if you keep eating it, you will eventually get sick and die. But even more than that, it perverts our appetite for spiritual things. Broccoli, carrots, tomatoes, grapes, pineapples can only be appreciated and they can only taste good when you stop eating the candy and the pizzas and the Popeyes. And just like it is with our appetite, it is the same thing when it comes to the things of God. As long as we are into the spectacular and the exciting, as long as we want church to be like how it is at the basketball game, as long as we want our spiritual experience to be like what we see on television, or to be as exciting as Scandal or Who How to Get Away with Murder, we will never have any appreciation for the Word of God. How can we? If your diet every day for the week is the latest reality show, 92.3, church will be boring. It will be. I'm just being honest. And it happens to all of us. We're all in danger of that. And so what he's saying is that this idea of wanting the senses excited, because that's what the pride of life is. It's about exciting the senses. Think about it in the story of Elijah. Elijah, after he fell, notice what he says. God came to him in a strong wind, and he said he wasn't there. Came in fire, he wasn't there. Came to a cloud of smoke, he wasn't there. But he said, in a still, small voice. Yeah. We know the story? So some of us, we want God to communicate it to us in the language of the exciting and the spectacular. When God wants to communicate to us with a still, small voice. And the only way to be able to appreciate God and what he has to say is to turn our hearts to him. It's all about the condition of our hearts, what we focus on, where our affections are. I want to read a quote. And White says, she says, the passion for earthly gain is increasing among those who profess to be looking for the soon appearing of our Savior. Talking about Seventh-day Adventists. She says, it's increasing in the church. So the Adventist church, the longer that it takes for Jesus to come, it's the more in love with the world the members become. So the early Adventists sold everything because they knew Jesus was coming. But today's Adventist is trying to gather everything to be comfortable while we wait for him to come. He says, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes control professed Christians. So they are believers who, because of their love for the world, Christ has been obscured, and they're now being controlled by the desires of this world. But notice what he says. He goes on to say in verse 17 and verse 16, so this idea of the pursuit of the world, it's dangerous because it causes to interrupt our connection and our relationship with God. But notice what he says about the world in verse 17, and the world is passing away. In other words, what the world is offering us is not permanent. It's not value. It's not of ultimate value. It is not reality. It is almost virtual reality. Think about it for a moment. Well, the world has, he said it's passing away. In other words, it's not going to be here. It has no lasting impact. You know, my kids, they love to play Minecraft and Roblox, and I realize it's the thrill of these games. They get to go into a virtual world and build things and be there and interact in a virtual world. And what the writer here is saying is that everything that the world is offering us, all of its success, all of its accolades, all of its awards, all of its applause, all of its pleasures, everything that it offers us, it's just a virtual reality. It's just a virtual reality. It's passing away. It's not real in the eyes of God. He says one day it is going to be destroyed. But notice what he says. But he who does the will of God abides forever. So the world is passing away. But the person that puts their faith in Jesus Christ, the young person that decides that they're going to do God's will, no matter what it costs, no matter how hard it is, no matter how humiliating it is to stand up and be faithful to God when everybody else around them seems to be doing something opposite, he says this person has eternity. They will live with me for eternity. Now I want to say this, my last point, I'm going to get ready to close, is that the reality is that we all suffer from a desire to be in the world. If we were really to explore it, a lot of times there's something that we're trying to fulfill that we try to fulfill in our careers. So we may feel inadequate personally. We may feel not liked. So if I do this, or if I accomplish this, this will cause me to feel better about myself. And if people recognize me, then that will mean I'm more secure. And what we realize is that if we keep doing all those things, that those of you who are locked in that cycle, the more you accomplish, the more that you do, is the more that you need to do in order to replenish that feeling when everybody called your name and recognized you. And what the writer is saying is that this pursuit is like drinking from a broken cistern, or it's like carrying a bag that has a hole in the bottom. No matter how much you fill it, it's going to keep leaking out. In other words, the world cannot satisfy. Only Jesus can satisfy. And the reality is we cannot do this in our own strength. We have all failed in our pursuit. But here is the gospel, the good news. Notice what he says in chapter 2, my last point. My little children, these things I write to you that you may not sin. I tell you these so that you won't sin. That's the goal. And if anyone sins, if you do fall, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous, and he himself is the propitiation, the substitute for our sins, and not for us only, but also for the whole world. You know, I really understood this text a couple years ago when we were in the building project for this building. And if you guys remember, we had one building firm, and as we got into it with that building firm, we realized what they were going to cost was going to be more than what we had to pay. And so we decided we needed to get out of the contract as a church. And the team of I, we'd been having different conversation with the leaders of this firm. And no matter what we said, could not convince them to release us out of this contract. But then we got a lawyer. And because, you know, I've never needed a lawyer before, or at least not able to afford one either. So we got a good lawyer. And we went into the meeting with this lawyer, and I watched them go back and forth. And what we could never say to them, the lawyer was able to say. And all we did was just sit there and watched him work. And when he was finished, we were released from that contract. And it was funny too, they were mad. When he finally got them, they were mad. But that's how Christ is for those who come to him. He is the lawyer and the judge. Oh, you're not with me today. Huh? He says, I wish that you didn't sin, but I'm going to defend for you. I'm going to cover you with my blood. I'm going to stand in your place. So even if you fall in your pursuit of me, if you fall, just turn to me and I will cover you. I will change your desires and your affections so that you will want me more than you want the world. See, that is something that we cannot do. Only God can do it. And he is willing and merciful enough to do it. That young lady that left her parents' house, she got a plane ticket and she flew to another country. That's how determined she was to get away from her mother. She left the country. She found an exotic location in Brazil. She went over there. She saved up her money. And she met some new friends. She was having a good time. She was partying and hanging out. And as fate would have it, she ran out of money. And when she ran out of money, she ran out of friends. She ran out of friends and she ran out of a place to live. So here she was, left her mother, and now homeless on the streets, walking through the streets of this exotic city. It was so bad that she'd brush her teeth in hotel lobbies, their bathrooms rather. She'd go in hotels and find their bathrooms. She'd wash up in there, brush her teeth, and she would just kind of wander aimlessly throughout the city, sleeping at bus stops and in park benches. But after a while, her mother realized, a month went by and she hadn't heard from her daughter, and she realized something must be wrong. I figured she'd be back by now. She'd come to her senses and realize she needs to be here. And so the mother now began to ask some of her friends, and her friends told her where she went. And so the mother bought a plane ticket and flew all the way to where her daughter was. And she went around and she was asking people where, you know, telling people her daughter's name. Nobody knew her. She had a picture of her daughter. She was showing it to everybody and nobody recognized her daughter. She went to places she thought that she might be hanging out, but she couldn't find it. And finally, she decided, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to go to a photo booth and I'm going to take a picture of myself. So she went in the photo booth and she took as many pictures of herself. You know, I don't know if you guys remember some of those photo booths where you can put a dollar in, and they have them at the Children's Museum now and you get your pictures right away. Well, she did a whole bunch of those, right? And then she wrote a note on the back of every picture, and then she took the pictures and she started putting them up all over the city. She put them in hotel bathrooms, and she put them at bus stops, and she put them in restaurants' bathrooms. And then she packed her bags and flew back home. One day her daughter, sad and depressed, stumbled down into the hotel bathroom to brush her teeth, tears in her eyes. And when she got in there, to her surprise, was the picture of her mother on the mirror. She was so overwhelmed, she began to sob. And then she takes the picture off of the mirror and she looks at it, crying. And then something tells her to turn it over, and she turns it over and she sees her mother had written her a personal note. She says, whatever you've done, wherever you've been, it does not matter. Please come home. And I want to tell you today, young people, and everybody sitting here today, that 2,000 years ago, Jesus took a picture of himself on the cross of Calvary. And he wrote a message to every generation with his blood. Whatever you've done, wherever you have been, it does not matter. Please come home. I want to tell you today that even when we disobey God, and go against his will, even when we spit in his face, he still has his arms wide open. The Bible says, why he says, don't love the world, John says it. It says, for God so loved the world. He loves us in our rebellion. And he loves us right back to him. So maybe there's somebody here today. Somebody here today. Somebody here today want to take a stand and say, you know what, Lord? I need special prayer because I realize that I love this world. And I don't want the world to get in the way of my relationship with you. I want to know what true love is. See, we love the world, but the world doesn't love us back. But when you love Jesus, he loves us more. Amen? And so today, for the person today, you want to say, Lord, I want you to transform my desire. First, help me to see how my pursuits in this world don't line up with yours, and take away that desire. That's your prayer today. You want to recommit yourself to God today. So, Lord, I want to be committed. I want to do your will. I want to walk in the light as you are in the light. This is your desire today. I want to invite you to stand to your feet. If you want to walk in the light as Christ is in the light, I want to encourage you to stand to your feet today.
The world that he gave his only begotten son, that
we desire to walk with God, he fulfills everything that we're trying to fulfill with the things in the world. He meets us right where we are. A lot of us are depressed. We are struggling. And it's because we won't just be obedient to God. He says, if you do this, he says, the way to abide, Jesus says, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in me. He's not just talking about the Ten Commandments. If you keep all of my word, if you walk with me, he says, you will experience joy. You will experience peace. You will experience everything that I have for you right now in this world. What Jesus wants to give us is more than the world could ever give us or any other human being. And the way to experience that is to walk in the light, to do his will, to surrender our hearts to him. And we'll experience him like we've never experienced him before. My second appeal is for the person today who wants to give their heart to Jesus Christ. You've never given your heart to him before. Maybe you've given it to him before, but you want to come back to him. You want to say, Lord, I want to give my heart to you again. This is your desire today. I want to invite you to come. Are you here today? Are you here today?
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Anybody else here today? You know, last night we talked about this idea of God's chosen generation. and what he is calling people to, people who are faithful to him, to bring glory to him, excuse me, to be witnesses to him, to the world, so that others can come to him. That's why he gave us all these talents and gifts, so that we can represent him, so that people can be led into the everlasting arms of the creator of the universe. That's what God wants us to do, is to lead others to him. Anybody else here today want to experience him today? You want to experience a close, intimate connection with God today like you've never experienced before? We want to invite you to come. You want to study the word. You want to be baptized. You want to know this Jesus that John knows, knew. You want to touch him. You want to hear his voice. You want to hear him speak to you. You want to look upon him. You can experience that today by giving your heart to him. Are you here today? Are you here today? Never giving your heart to him. Doesn't matter what you've done. You don't have to try to get yourself together before you come. Don't try to answer all of the questions. Well, God, if I come to you, I'm struggling with this. No, just come to him now. He'll take care of all your questions and all of your struggles. Just come to him. Anybody else here today? Anybody else here today? Anybody else here today? We're getting ready to pray. Anybody else here today want to give their heart to him? Every head is bowed, every eye is closed. Father in heaven, oh Lord, we want to thank you for your goodness towards us. We want to thank you that you so desire for us to be in relationship with you that you warn us of those things that distort and obscures you from our vision. Lord, you've shown us today in your word that selfish, self-centered desires aimed for our own glory leads us away from you. We can't love you and pursue those things at the same time. So Lord, for some of us, it's hard to give up on these things because our whole identity, we find meaning and significance in life because of these pursuits. But Lord, may we find meaning and significance in you. May your, this is my son, this is my daughter, in whom I am well pleased, be enough for us. Lord, we're standing here today because we want to walk with you. Forgive us, God, for where we've turned away from you. Lord, I pray that you give us new desires, new hearts. Help us to be able to appreciate who you are and your word. Lord, I pray for our young people today. Lord, they're living in a generation in the most secular generation in history. The most blatantly rebellious against God than any other generation. And yet you have called them to be faithful witnesses for you. Lord, I pray that they would not love the world, but that they would love you more. Keep them, God. Help them to come to know the joy of a relationship with you. And Lord, I pray for the person that has come to give their heart to you today. Lord, I pray today that you would bring your peace and assurance to her heart. Bring joy to her heart today. May she know that the work that you have started in her, that you will complete it. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. God bless you.
He will save you. He will save you just now. Just now. He will save you. He will save you just now.
Personally, I want to give God praise again because today he has done some hard cleaning, and I thank him for that. So we have coming to us today, Tanisha Reed. She has already been baptized, but she wants to deepen her relationship with her Savior.
Happy Sabbath. Can we all please stand for the benediction? May the saving grace of our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit abide with you all, now and forevermore. Amen.